Well, today's the day. The Prime Minister's given us a date for the referendum on his voice, and it's great to have my good friends Jacinta Nambajimba-Price and Warren Mundine here to talk about what is at stake with this divisive proposal. So I'm going to invite Jacinta to speak and then Warren, and we'll take questions after that.
Thank you very much, Jono. I'm really glad to be here in Hobart, in Tasmania, one of our battleground states going toward this referendum. So division, division, division. That's basically what this referendum is about. It's been this since the beginning. And this is the decision that Australians are going to have to make now on October 14. Do we divide our country along the lines of race within our nation's rule book? Do we divide our country, within our constitution? The Prime Minister is suggesting that this is the only way forward to support our most marginalised Indigenous Australians. At no point did he actually make reference to Indigenous Australians who he claims this proposal is supposed to support going forward. He made reference to corporates, he made reference to community groups, to faith groups, but he didn't make reference to the people that I represent in my constituency, some of our most marginalised Indigenous Australians. It is evident to me that this elite proposal is about division in our country. And it is that old rule of divide and conquer that I can't stand for. I'm not going to allow a line to run straight through the middle of my family within our constitution. I don't expect that to take place within our country, to be treating Indigenous Australians differently to the rest of Australia because of our racial heritage. You know, there's so many times the Prime Minister references the referendum of 1967. That referendum came about with overwhelming support from Australians to bring about equality in our country for Indigenous people through equality of citizenship, through education, through access to opportunity. Like all other Australians, we have created equality in this country. It is wrong to suggest we have not had a voice. Voices like mine, elected parliamentarians, voices like my good friend Warren Mundine, are speaking up. We are telling this Prime Minister our voices are relevant. The voices of those Indigenous people in this country that we represent who do not support this, who did not participate in the Uluru dialogues, have spoken up. The Prime Minister is effectively ignoring us. So to suggest that we have not had a voice is completely and utterly misleading. And we will not allow for the Prime Minister and this referendum to divide our country along the lines of race within our constitution.
Thank you. Jacinta's right. This thing is about division and dividing this country and the racial abuse that we've been hearing over the last few months. You know, everyone knows the pressure that was put on me to send me almost to suicidal positions. And this is what this Prime Minister has done. This Prime Minister from day one had attacked people who had a different opinion to him, called them names, and that opened up the floor for the whole division to start with all the horrible racial abuse, with all the horrible bigotry that's been going on out there, and it's all Albo. He's the one who started this. He's the one who's brought it out. And if he thinks that the voice is the answer to fixing everything, this magic wand, then he's not answering the real question. The real question is out there is about how do we help people who are in tremendous problems in Aboriginal communities out there? And what's his answer? We're going to spend hundreds of millions of dollars, which could be better spent in those communities, and him flying around the country with his happy clapping crowd, which is not going to do anything for these people. I'm very angry about this because I and my family have grew up under the segregation laws in the 1950s and 60s. We know what it was like. And this is what they're going. We fought for equality. We fought to be treated the same as every other Australian, whether they're here in 5 minutes or they're here for the 160,000 years or whatever it is, the number is going to be next week. We here about building a liberal democracy of freedoms and liberties and equality, not dividing our nation by race. And I will swear on my mother and father's grave that I will fight this, and I'll be out there every day champion the wonderful country that we got, which is not a racist group of people. We're not a racist country with all these elite corporate people and football codes and everyone say we are. And we've got a wonderful, gorgeous country, and we're heading in the right direction. No more division. We are out there to crush this division.
Take a few questions now, guys.
True. If you're someone who says they want to improve the lives of Aboriginal people but intend to vote no like you guys, what can they do to make a tangible difference, you know, moving forward?
Well, firstly, by voting no to dividing our country along the lines of race and relegating Indigenous Australians to an unknown, detailless, risky and permanent entity. This is not how you solve problems for Indigenous Australians. The Prime Minister has failed to actually provide any evidence whatsoever that demonstrates how it will improve the lives of Indigenous Australians. What we need to do is get our hands dirty and do what actually has not been done. A bloated bureaucracy has been done time and time again. To suggest to put it in our constitution makes it magically effective is wrong. What we haven't done is we haven't looked into where the billions of dollars are being spent year in, year out, to determine how they can be better spent, to determine who has been misspending the money and apply real accountability to that. We haven't worked to fix the structures that currently exist, the organisations that currently exist that have the responsibility to improve the lives of Indigenous Australians. And it's certainly my job as an elected parliamentarian to do that. I've kicked this process off with my good friend and colleague, Senator Karen Little, yep, to call for an inquiry into Land Council, statutory authorities, Aboriginal organisations that are federally funded to improve the lives of Indigenous Australians. That's how we begin to fix the problems.
Exactly. And there's only one word that we need that can fix the entire problem, and that's accountability. They have been spending $33 billion annually on Aboriginal affairs. I went and did some of the sums over the last 50 years of the money spent, and it's nearly $1 trillion. The question's got to be asked, what have you done with that money? If I had $1 trillion, we could fix the problems within Aboriginal communities today. But no, these people are spending all this money. They got to be held accountable for it. You know, and for the last 12 months since this government's come to power, what have they done? All they talked about is the voice. You know, that is not going to fix the problems on the ground. Albo and the Minister for Indigenous Australians were dragged by you blokes, kicking and screaming to Alice Springs to deal with the issues up there. And he spent less time there than he did at the tennis drinking beer. These blokes we do not trust. We do not trust what they're saying. And they are going to divide. Well, they're not going to divide it. They divided this country already, into on racial lines and on bigotry.
There's data showing that people who support the no side will avoid voting altogether. How concerned are you about low voter turnouts?
Well, look, we're encouraging all Australians to participate because the Constitution belongs to each and every Australian. As part of the No campaign, I've been getting out there, Warren's been getting out there, we've been before audiences right across the country, and the audiences that have turned up to our events have been huge. So it's demonstrated to us that there has been a great turnout for those who want to maintain equality in this country, and we're encouraging those people to ensure that they're having the conversations with their family members, that they are informed, and that they are participating in this very important decision to amend our constitution, and we'll continue to do so up until referendum day.
You're in Hobart right now. Why are you seeing Tasmania as an important place to campaign?
Well, as part of our strategy with the No campaign, we've been focusing on the battleground states that we know, are likely to be able to be swayed to provide a no vote toward the referendum. And Tasmania is one of those states, and as recent polling suggests, Tasmania is now trending toward the no. So We're very pleased with that because we know that our hard work has been paying off. The fact that also Australians are becoming more informed with this debate. And that's I think, a really important point, is that when Australians do some research and look further into this and don't just take the Prime Minister's words on face value, they are more likely actually to turn their votes to no.
Yeah, you have to look at social media to see the varied reasons why people are voting yes or no. Is there any level of discomfort that you're on the same side of the debate with people who do hold bigoted views? Is there any level of discomfort there? That, and what would you say to those people who are not coming at this in good faith and are voting no for backward reasons?
Well, I've always said from day one, the Prime Minister, stop abusing people, stop attacking people. Noel Pearson, who racially abused me in the Australian newspaper, you know, they've got to stop that. And I've always said that the Prime Minister needs to sit down with the Minister, with the Leader of the Opposition, come together and actually say to the Australian public, bigotry, racial abuse, lies and distortions should not be set out there. We should have the Yes campaign should be able to prosecute their case. We should be able to prosecute that case in a mature, sensible democracy way.
Absolutely. And look, you know, that bigotry has come thick and fast. We've been subjected to that from Yes campaigners. It was only just on Monday when our good colleague Tony Passon's office was had an individual come into that office and verbally abuse his staff as well as a 15-year-old kid who was there doing work experience and wrecked the office in throwing pamphlets all over the floor. We have been from the get-go asking for respectful debate going forward. We should always have the opportunity to have respectful debate on any issue in our nation. People like myself and Warren shouldn't have to be subjected to racial vilification by anybody, and that goes both ways.
Yeah, it does.
There are Indigenous people in this country who will racially vilify white people. As we know, there's white people that racially vilify Aboriginal people. We're asking everybody to be respectful.
Two more questions, guys.
Would you work alongside the government if the Yes campaign does come to fruition?
We will always fight. Well, I will always fight for closing that gap. I've been doing it. My lifetime has been spent on it. I've got a track record of doing things, employing things. I'm one of the largest Indigenous employers in the country, and I work for a company like FMG, which is the largest employer of Aboriginal people in the country, getting them trades, jobs, education, building a safe and better future for them. So our track record is quite clear. We will continue to do that. We will continue to work for reconciliation. This silly idea that reconciliation finishes if the No campaign gets up is just nonsense.
With Tasmania as a key battleground, have you spoken to the Tasmanian Premier, the only Liberal Premier in Australia who is supporting the Yes campaign? Have you spoken to him at all?
I have invited my Tasmanian colleagues to come and be part of and come and attend some of the events that we've had here. The invitations have gone out. They've not expressed any sort of enthusiasm to have any conversations or those sorts of things. I think it's important that they should also speak to members of their Indigenous community here. I know that I've had engagements with members of the Indigenous community here, the Circle Head organisation, which is in Smithton in the north here, have expressed very loudly that they're not in support. Obviously, you know, you've got Michael Mansell, who's another Indigenous person, who doesn't support this going forward. I would hope to think that all parliamentarians that come from Tasmania are having those conversations with the Indigenous members of the community that don't support this proposal going
forward.
And
I'll tell you how good we are. Last night I was in Brisbane and I went down to Beenleigh, and on the stage with me was Julia Lisa, who is Liberal and is pro-voice, and me. And we had an amazing discussion and conversation. And the people in the audience, the several hundred people in that audience, they can now go away and after listening to both sides and do that. Father Frank Brennan, as you know, is the constitutional lawyer, Jesuit, son of the Chief Justice Brennan. And we've had two stages together. He's prosecuted the yes campaign, I prosecuted the no campaign. Civil, decent conversations. We got a track record of doing that.
And that's what we'll maintain.
And we'll keep on doing that. Every event that we have, we invite them, the yes campaign to come and stand and prosecute their case.
Thank you, guys. That's all for now.
Thank you.